गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रण्वन्नूतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात्परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ॐ शन्नो मित्रः शं वरुणः शन्नो भवत्वर्यमा शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः शन्नो विष्णुरुरुक्रमः। नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्मामवतु तद्वक्तारमवतु अवतु माम् अवतु वक्तारम्। ओम शांति शांति शांति। डियर फ्रेंड्स, इन द लास्ट क्लास वी कंप्लीटेड द स्टडी ऑफ तैत्तिरीय उपनिषद, दैट इज वी रेड द 10th अनुवाक ऑफ भृगुवल्ली राइट अप टू द लास्ट लाइन ऑफ शंकराचार्यस भाष्यम वी स्टडीड। And you were saying that we have completed about 85 classes, 85 hours. Okay, today is the 86th hour. So in this hour, we will try to summarize what all we have studied in Taittiriya Upanishad. It may be difficult to recapitulate all the points, so I will broadly summarize, so that we can finish it in 1 hour. So we have seen from the beginning that in all the Upanishads, we have so far studied about 4 Upanishads, Isha, Kena, Katha and also this Taittiriya. And we have seen in all these Upanishads, there is a general structure. Say generally, the Upanishads, they give some idea about what Jiva is. Some Upanishads, they give in detail, some Upanishads, they just mention in a passing way. So about Jiva, there is something told about what is the nature of Jiva. Then Jagat or Srushti, whatever it is, the world, the universe, the creation, whatever it is, in whatever way you want to say. About that, of course, while talking about Jiva only, incidentally, that also comes. Jiva and Jagat. What is the relationship between Jiva and Jagat? Then, what is the nature of the Supreme Reality? What we call Ishvara. Ishvara is not Lord Ishvara and Parvati, not that. Ishvara is Brahma, what we call Brahma. So, what is the nature of this Brahma? What is the nature of that Supreme Reality? So, that is another point. Then how to reach that stage or how to attain that stage? Reaching is not a physical movement. Reaching is understanding. Our understanding itself is reaching. Avagati reva gatihi. Understanding itself is movement. Otherwise there is no movement, physical movement, there is no physical attainment. So what are the means to attain that stage? What are the means to attain that realization? What is the type of spiritual discipline that is needed for a person to attain that particular level of understanding? So that is the sadhanani. So that also, they are also told sadhanani. Then about jnani. So ultimately, okay, you are calling some gentleman as a jnani, as a realized person. So how is he different from us? What exactly is the, what makes the difference? How is he also reacting like us to all the things? How is he, what is his attitude to various things? Like Arjuna questions, ka bhasha sthita prajnyasya ka bhasha samadhisthasya keshava sthitahi kim prabhasheta kim asita etc. etc. What is his attitude to life? How does he face various issues, situations? So is he happy or unhappy? Is he afraid of various things or is he beyond fear? So various things, that is one thing. So these 4-5 things are told about generally in the Upanishads. And Taittiriya Upanishad, we have seen, is not a very big Upanishad like Brihadaranyaka or Chandogya, but it is third in size. If we see the 10 Upanishads, 10 major Upanishads, if we take into consideration, this is the third largest in size. So after Brihadaranyaka and Chandogya, this is again fairly big. Compared to Ishavasya, Kena, Katha, etc., it is much big. And also in terms of the commentary of Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya has commented on certain points in a very, very elaborate, very incisive, very thorough manner. So we saw all that bhashyam. So this Upanishad actually, it covers all these aspects. Some other Upanishads may cover only one aspect or two aspects, but then this Upanishad is telling about Jiva, Jagat, then Brahma, the Sadhanani, and again Jnanisthiti, what is the nature of this Jnani. So all these points it is covering. So here we have also seen that Upanishads have got a very, very rational approach to know the reality. Rational approach means the methodology used is debate, discussion. The methodology is debate, discussion, thinking. It is not a dogma. It is not something which somebody says, Father, Brahmavayuvarunihi, when the son goes to the father, okay, please, father, tell me what is Brahma. Okay, the father does not say, okay, this is what is Brahma, you jolly well believe in this. It's not like that. You have to think, you have to yourself realize what exactly is that. So that is the approach. The methodology in Upanishads is, in all the Upanishads, the methodology is that of discussion, debate, and not of dogma. So that is another point. That is one important beginning point. Then, if we see this, the structure of this Upanishad, we have seen that it is in three parts. One is the Shikshavalli, the second is Anandavalli, and the third is Bhruguvalli. And we have seen that in this Shikshavalli, there are various Upasanas which have been told. Shikshavalli, it started with, Shiksham, Vyakhya, Syamaha. So, like that, what is Shiksha? We have seen that Paniniya Shiksha and various other texts of Shiksha. What we have seen, Shiksha is one of the branches of Veda, Vedangani. Shiksha, Vyakaranam, Chandas, etc., etc. There are six Vedangani. This is one Vedanga. This is one Vedanga. That is one of the auxiliary studies for thoroughly understanding Veda. So, how a word has to be understood, how a word has to be pronounced. So, this is it. And this knowledge is very, very essential for a proper understanding of Veda. Shiksha is essential for a proper understanding of Veda. So, that is the importance of that Shiksha. In the very beginning, what do the parents teach the children? The children, if they are mispronouncing certain words, first of all, they teach them how to pronounce that particular word. How to pronounce that particular word. And how to combine the words and then how to form the sentences, etc. The parents teach the children. So in the same manner, the Shiksha about how words have to be, letters have to be pronounced, words have to be pronounced, words have to be combined and things like that, all such thing has been told. And similarly, in the next thing also, Upasana, Samhitopasana. Samhitopasana is again the similar thing. Samhitopasana is again a very similar Upasana where certain groups have been identified and those groups have been meditated upon. So that is one thing. And here Shankaracharya has given a very working definition, or why working definition, a very thorough definition of what is an Upasana. Upasana, he said, Tailadharavat Tulya Pratyaya Santatihi Asankirnacha Atat Pratyayahi, etc. That is, like a small stream of oil which is poured from a pointed beaker. Suppose there is a pointed beaker. From that beaker you pour oil, which is quite viscous. So that is, it forms a thread. It forms an unbroken thread. You pour water, it breaks. Water breaks into small globules. But there, if you pour oil, it is a thin line. Tailadharavat Tulya Pratyaya Santatihi. So the similar stream of thought, similar thought stream, suppose you are meditating on a particular subject, similar thought stream, undisturbed by dissimilar thought stream, asankirnacha atat pratyayaihi, that is undisturbed by or unmixed by any dissimilar thoughts. So that is what is the Upasana. And then we have seen two types of Upasanas. Of course, in Upanishad, we see only Vaidika Upasana. But generally, we are also aware of other Upasanas. That is Laukika Upasana. Somebody is doing Upasana on Hanuman, and somebody on Saraswati, somebody on Rishimhopasaka, etc., etc. There, it is a sort of personal connection between the Upasaka and the deity. A sort of personal equation. He finds that Lord Narasimhaswami as his father, a friend, philosopher, guide, etc. And then it is a sort of sounding board where he can tell all his worries. If he has some quarrel within his house, he goes and tells his Vinayaka, Lord Narasimha. So that is a symbol which enables us to devote, to pour our heart there, to express our grievances. It is some sort of redressal, grievance redressing, redressal mechanism. So the objective is there, the objective again is there is another type of upasana. Upasana again, even in the Laukika upasana, there are two things. One is at the devotee and then the God, that duality is very much there. But in another thing, you are of course doing worship of a particular deity, but it is ahangraha upasana. That is, I am that deity. To that level you have to grow. So you have to do upasana on that deity and then you grow up to that level. So that is ahangraha upasana. Upasaka identifies with the deity. So these are the laukika upasanas we have seen. But in this, say, Taittiriya Upanishad, what is the type of upasanas we see? It is not about a deity. It is not about any saguna form. It is about what is the universe around you and what is the connection between me and the universe. I have a body, I have got this body-mind complex and then this Annamaya Sharira consisting of five senses and then these five senses, they correspond to the five, say, elements which are there in the, say, creation. And then these five elements themselves are manifest in me in the form of these five senses. And then there is a mind which is a collective derivative of these five elements. It is a collective derivative, isn't it? Of these five elements from the sattvika amsha of all the five elements, this is a collective, evolute, let us say. So this is what we see. So from saguna level we come to the stage of the cosmic gross body, and then again the cosmic gross, cosmic mind, and then we see what is our relation with that Virat, or what is our relation with that Hiranyagarbha. So this is what is there in this, the uniqueness of Vaidika Upasana. And then the Upasaka slowly realizes that what is there as his individual self, this Vyashti, is not something which is different from that Samashti. In other words, Vyashti is the microcosm, Samashti is the macrocosm. This Vyashti is not different from Samashti, means this microcosm, this body is not different from, it cannot independently exist. It cannot exist independently of that macrocosm. It is a product, or it is another form of the same, product also it is a correct word. It is another form of that macrocosm. So this is what he realizes. So this is a sort of taking the idea of one's own self to a different level. In a normal upasana, your self is intact, it is unchanged. You are doing Nrisimhopasana, you are there, you are a grihastha, you are having some problems, you are expressing all your problems before the Lord. So you have no, there is no change in your status or change in your notion of yourself. But here there is a change, there is a gradual change in the notion of self. So your limited personality is gone and then you are trying to identify with a larger personality. So this is the type of vision, this is a sort of integral vision to see oneness in all, to see that one is, he is not different from anything else. So this is what we see. And whatever is in this body, that is Adhyatmika, is the same at the level of Adhibhautika. And it is the same in that Adhidaiva, Adhidaivika level also, that is the same. So this is the vision that is ultimately achieved by these upasanas. So these upasanas are basically spiritual exercises which facilitate in arriving at such vision. So this is what we see in Vaidika upasanas which are told in this Shikshavalli. And Shikshavalli, if we see the Anuvakas, if we see basically expanding, in other words we can say this is expanding our idea of our own self from a limited personality to a very cosmic level. So that is, it is expanding. Or in other words, it is not an inflation of ego, it is total deflation of ego. So that is, these are the things which we see in this upasanas. And if we see, the upasanas are like that. Number, if we see the fourth anuvaka in the first valli, it is about a chandasam rishabho vishwarupaha. That is about the Omkara upasana. We have seen this Omkara upasana not only in this fourth anuvaka but also in the eighth anuvaka. And then regarding Omkara, the importance of Omkara, how this particular symbol has been arrived at, we had a very big discussion about what exactly is A, what does A signify, what does U signify, A, U, Ma, what do those symbols, what do they symbolize, and then how the whole Shabda Prapancha, that is, what all words we utter, what in whatever language is there, they are all symbolized under this, they can be symbolically brought under this symbol called Om. They can be brought under this symbol Om, A, Uma. They can all be brought under. When you bring in all the Shabda Prapancha, naturally the world of forms and names, that is automatically say, brought in. So like that, and Omkara, it has also say relation with this the three states, that is waking, dream and say deep sleep state, and also Turiya. So all that we discussed in detail while talking about this Omkara Upasana in this fourth Anuvaka and also in the eighth Anuvaka. And then if you see the other Anuvaka called say fifth Anuvaka, in this fifth Anuvaka, Vyahruti, Bhur Bhuvasu Varitiva Yetastisro Vyahrutayaha, that is Vyahruti. Vyahriyate iti Vyahruti. Vyahruti is a sacred utterance. Vyahruti is a sacred utterance. We say Bhuhu Bhuvaha Suvaha Maha Janaha Tapaha. These are all certain sacred utterances symbolically referring to certain states. So this Bhuhu Bhuvaha Bhu represents the earth. Bhuvaha represents this intermediate space. Suvaha represents the Adhidaiva level. Adhidaiva level is Surya. Surya Adhidaiva level, Suvarna Jyotihi. That last line in the last class we read. Suvaha represents, means Aditya. Then Mahaha. Mahaha represents above all these things at Hiranyagarbha Tattvam, which is the first born, Prathamaja, Hiranyagarbha. That is that Prathama Tattvam, which we see in that thing. So Bhuhu, Bhuvaha, Suvaha, Mahaha, at various levels, what do they symbolize? So that is what we saw in this Pancham Anuvaka. Then again, in the sixth Anuvaka, we see another wonderful thing. That is the Upasana of this, Hiranyagarbha, in your own Hrudayakasha. Hrudaya does not mean the physical heart, but the Buddhi Guha. In that Buddhi Guha, the cave called Buddhi, the cave called intellect or intellect cave. In that intellect cave, you are visualizing the presence of that Hiranyagarbha. This is again Upasana level only, not the realization level. We have seen that a realized person, he has awareness. He has awareness that he is one with that Hiranyagarbha, he is one with that Brahman. So, but here he has to consciously practice. This sadhaka has to consciously practice. Whatever are the krutarthasya, we have to recall the line from Gita Bhashya. Sarvatrahi Vedanta Shastre krutarthasya lakshanani yani tani sadhanani, tanyeva sadhanani for a seeker. So whatever are the characteristics of a krutartha, of a realized person, they have to be consciously cultivated by a seeker. So that is what we have seen. So here also, yayesha antarhrutaya hrudaya akashaha, in that is called dharopasana. The dharopasana, there, though Brahman is present everywhere, but this is this buddhi guha, which is the vishesha abhivyakti sthanam. That is where this is specially manifest, exclusively manifest, and it can be found. And the example we recalled was that of electricity. Electricity is found in a wire, but it is not seen in that wire, unless we touch, of course. But then it is seen in a bulb where there is a filament. So this heart is a place where this, not heart, this Buddhi Guha or the intellect cave is a place where this Brahman, that in the form of chit, is manifest very, very effectively. Vishesha abhivyakti sthanam. So that is what we have seen. So, the point, basic principle is, there is no difference between the ghata akasha and mata, mahakasha or mata akasha, whatever it is. So like that, similarly, the intelligence which is there in this buddhi guha is the same as that supreme intelligence. So that is what we see. And the result, what is the result of all this thing? Result of all this thing we have seen there, the dissociating with whatever limited social identity you have, and then staying without real identity. It does not happen right now immediately for the sadhaka, but sadhaka is moving in that direction. He is consciously doing some sort of superimposition. And one important point in upasana is, it is a shastriya adhyasa. There are two types of adhyasa. Adhyasa means superimposition, isn't it? Superimposition can be two ways. One is by ignorance. That is, atasmin tadbuddhihi adhyasa, Shankaracharya says. And something which is not that, we are thinking it as that. X is not Y, but we are seeing as Y. So like that. That is adhyasa. That is due to ignorance. But then in upasana, it is a shastriya adhyasa. It is something which is permitted, not only permitted, it is recommended by Shastra, in order to reach a particular level. द शास्त्र विल नॉट से यू आर ए फूल यू आर ए फूल यू आर ए फूल इफ यू शास्त्र सेज यू आर ए फूल आर यू आर ए पापी आर ए सिन्नर दट मैन विल कंटिन्यूअसली फील दट ही इज ए सिन्नर आर ए पापी आर ए फूल बट शास्त्र सेज यू आर नॉट ए फूल यू आर वन विद दट ब्रह्मन यू डू दिस उपासना एंड यू आर वन विद दट यू विल बिकम दट डेटी सो दिस इज ए शास्त्रीय अध्यास वेर ही कॉन्शियसली ट्राइज टू ट्रांसफॉर्म हिमसेल्फ एंड बिकम दट पर्टिक्युलर डेटी आर realize, gradually realize. So this is another Shastriya Adhyasa which we have to see. So this is one thing. Then seventh Anuvaka is the Pankta. Pankta means groups of five. The entire universe is seen as groups of five. And then that again is an upasana of the same Hiranyagarbha. Prithivyantariksham Diyavruddhisho Antaradishah. That particular Anuvaka. This is again upasana of this Hiranyagarbha. And then eighth anuvaka, as we said, Om iti Brahma, Om iti idagam sarvam, that Om, Om. Then again, ninth anuvaka is not an upasana. Ninth anuvaka is about, say, balancing the spiritual pursuit. We are all spiritual seekers. So balancing our spiritual pursuit also with dharma. Because every person cannot renounce, every person is not a renounced person. And this is one thing which is a quite interesting anuvaka. ऋतंच स्वाध्याय प्रवचने च सत्यंच स्वाध्याय प्रवचने च तपश्च स्वाध्याय प्रवचने च स्वाध्याय एंड प्रवचन आर द कॉमन फैक्टर्स विथ ऑल अदर थिंग्स ऋतम ओके यू हैव टू फॉलो दट ऋतम सत्यम यू हैव टू फॉलो तपस यू हैव टू फॉलो दमः शमः अग्नयः अग्नयः मीन्स यूर आर ऑल नेचुरल रिचुअल्स एंड यज्ञास एंड व्हाट नॉट देन अतिथयश्च स्वाध्याय प्रवचने च यू हैव टू टेक केयर ऑफ युअर गेस्ट You have to have children. Prajacha swadhyaya pravachanecha. Obviously, it means you have to be a grihastha. Then prajanascha swadhyaya pravachanecha. Children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, etc. You have to have. So, all these things. So, there Shankara Bhashya points out one thing. That is, you should not abdicate dharma because of your passion for jnana. And likewise, you should not abdicate jnana in spite of all the worldly accompaniments and in spite of all your worldly, whatever duties are there, according to your ashrama, according to your, dharma. So this is what we see. This is an important thing here. So then the tenth one again is an upasana. Aham vrukshasya reriva. This is iti trishankor veda anuvachanam. Trishanku is a realized person. So that the Trishanku has told something. And whatever that Trishanku has said, this Upasaka is repeating and then he is trying to reach that level. Aham Vrukshasya Reriva, I am the controller, I am the person, Pravartaka, Rerivai, Pravartaka, I am the Pravartaka, I am the person who is in charge of this whole world. So that is how I am the controller of this, tree. What is that tree? The creation itself is the tree. Creation itself as a tree, we have seen in Kathopanishad also, Urdhvamuna Vadhashyakam. Then again, there is another Gita Bhashyam also, Gita itself, Urdhvamula Vakshyakha, that is Kathopanishad. Urdhvamula Madhashyakam is Gita. So we have seen that. So this Brahma Jnani, how is to break that tree? It is by only by Jnanam that you can break that tree. Vruksham. Vruksha. The etymological meaning is vrashyate, vrashyate iti vrukshaha, that which can be wrecked, that which can be destroyed. Wreck and vrushya, if you see W-R-E-C-K and vrushya, they seem to be totally cognate words. So that which can be wrecked, that which can be broken, that which can be destroyed, is that samsara. Samsara is that vruksha. And that vruksha can be broken by jnana only. So that is what we have seen. Kirti prushtam gireriva. So that is all the declaration of a realized person which is being consciously practiced by the seeker. That is one thing. Then 11th anuvaka, that is about Vedamanu Uchyacharyonte Vasinamanu Shasti. It is a very, very popular passage. Wherever you go to meetings or something, sabhas, where somebody, some Veda Pandit comes and then recites some Veda. So usually he recites this particular portion. Veda Manuchyacharyonte Vasina Manu Shasti Satyam Vada Dharmanchara, etc., etc. They recite. And this is something like a convocation speech. you go to a university at the time of convocation, so it is like somewhat like a convocation speech where the teacher gives lot of advice to the student as to what exactly is his dharma after he passes out. This is something like passing out, say, speech. Then this is again, this talks about the Shrauta Karma and also the Smartha Karmas, and say how a person has to develop good samskara. Samskara is good predisposition, samskara. So good predispositions by proper conduct, proper dharmic behavior. And then it also talks about what is dharma in different contexts. If you have a doubt about what is your dharma, what are you supposed to do? Ye tatra brahmana sammarshinaha, whatever respectable people do there, that is the dharma in that area. Because dharma is not something which is inflexible. Dharma is again flexible. There are certain aspects of dharma which are inflexible, no doubt. That is satyam, vada, dharma, chara, etc., etc. But in such a place, what exactly is the achara? What is the vyavahara? What is the conduct? About the conduct, etc. There are certain small things which can vary. So this is depending on desha, kala, nimitta. So that is what we see here. You go to another place, you have some doubt about your conduct, about your what exactly is the right behavior there. Then you follow whoever are the good people there. Etatra brahmana sammarshinaha. Sammarshinaha is samadarshinaha. Yes? Then yuktaha, ayuktaha. So those who are actually, they are basically dedicated to this dharma. So that is aluksha, dharma kamasyuhu. So that is what they say. So it is something like a great convocation speech by some visiting professor or somebody like that. Then we come to, after seeing all these upasanas and also some other general advices, this upasana is basically, as we have seen, it is to help the seeker to discard his idea of limited self and grow to a sarvatma bhava. And sarvatma bhava is something which is you just do not find in any other place, in any other culture, I mean. So this is the sarvatma bhava is one point which is told in our Upanishads. Sarvatma, in fact, why I tell this is, there is a general criticism that you Indians, you are not bothered about, you are only bothered about self-knowledge, you are not bothered about society. So we are not here to dictate to society. Our approach is, we have to modify ourselves. Our duty is not to beat others and then change others. It is not our policy. Our policy is to change ourselves. So that is what is it. You undergo change and then you become a responsible citizen and then you develop sarvatma bhava and then you love people without any sort of strings or anything like that. An unconditional love for everything. So that is what is the result of this sarvatma bhava. It is not something which is dictated by religion. It is something which is which arises in the mind of a seeker by proper contemplation. It is a result of contemplation and not the result of a dictation by a religion. So that is what is the difference. So then we come to this Brahmanandavalli. This Brahmanandavalli we have seen. Brahmanandavalli is the section where we find a beautiful definition of what is the Supreme Reality. This is another thing which cannot be challenged by anybody. Satyam, Jnana, Manantam, Brahma. It is something which cannot be challenged by anybody at any point of time. Because Brahman is something which is existence in common. Not a particular existence, not a Vishesha, but a Samanya, Sama-existence. That which is existing at all times and which, the existence of which cannot be refuted at any point of time. Trikala Badhyam, beyond the Kala. So that is what we have seen. And because all the things they keep changing, whatever things you see in the world, they all change. Change means they are all vikaris. Then ultimately what exactly is the thing which is unchanged? The idea of Sat, the notion of Sat, that existence is something which is unchanging. So this unchanging, when you say that this is the karanam or the cause for all the so-called effects, then like all other karanam, one can say that it is something called jadam. It is something which is insentient. So to avoid that contingency of this satyam being insentient, there is a word called jnanam. Satyam Brahma, Jnanam Brahma, Anantam Brahma. So that is how we have to see that thing, that particular line. Satyam Brahma, Jnanam Brahma, Anantam Brahma. So why these three points are noted there? Satyam Brahma, to say that Brahma is the source for all things. It is the karanam for all. When you say that, it may, the contingency may arise where that is because this is again a jada padartha. So to say that it is not jadam, satyam, jnanam, that word has been used there. Of course, there is a very elaborate discussion. I think we spent about 10 to 12 classes on the commentary on this satyam, jnanam, anantam, brahma, and then akashadvayuhu, that srushti, shruti. So then we had a very detailed discussion. There we have found in very, very brief manner, this is what I am saying. So jnanam, it is said it is jnanam. When you say jnanam, what is jnanam? So jnanam is I am seeing this thing. This jnanam of this particular water tumbler is there in my mind. I see some other book. This is another jnanam. So is it that type of jnanam where there is a jnana kartru, that is somebody who is seeing something and something which is seen. Suppose you say the God is omniscient. That is, God knows everything. God knows what is in my mind, God knows what is in your mind, etc., etc. That is what we say. Suppose you say that, then what does it mean? God is somebody sitting elsewhere and all other people are there. God is so capable that he knows whatever is there in your mind and my mind. So what does it mean? After all, God is different and you are different. It means God is a parichinna vyakti. Parichinna means limited. He may be a supercomputer, he may be much, much better than supercomputer, but then it is a limited entity. So in order to avoid that contingency, the word anantam has been used, because that jnanam is jnana swarupa. It is not, say, jnanam related to, there is a jnata, jnatru, jnata, jnayam and jnanam, that triputi is not there, that triputi rahita. This is jnana swarupa, which is devoid of this tripartite division. Jnana swarupa, devoid of this tripartite division called jnanam, jnayam and jnata. So this is what we have seen there. And to avoid that, it is said anantam, because there is no knower and known division. There is no division of knower, known, etc. Because, and it is anantam. So that is how it has been defined there. So then, then comes the next question. We have seen this Srushti, say, Shruti. That is, Srushti Shruti is about Tasmadvaya, Tasmadatmana, Akasha Sambhutaha, Akasha Dvayuhu, Vayuragnihi. It is all, we also discussed that. It is almost similar to Darwin's theory of evolution. We have discussed that also, because in Vedanta, it is almost like, say, endorsing the theory of evolution. And then, Also, one with the nebular theory which the physicists they talk about. So, Akasha Dvayuhu Vayu Ragnihi, how this thing, all this thing, this is a sequence in which all these things seem to have emerged. So, that is another thing which we have to see. The question is, when Brahman is Ananta, that is, Brahman is all pervading and there is nothing else apart from Brahman, when you say that, then what about this world? You are saying Akasha Dvayuhu, Vayuragnihi, Agni Rapaha, etc., etc., and then right up to Jiva, Annat Purushaha. So we are saying up to that. So you are expressing all that. It is all okay. For somebody, for a dualist, there is no problem at all. For a dualist, he says, yes, it is in conformity, not in conformity, it is actually endorsing. In fact, I always doubt whether Darwin and people like that, he might have got this idea of evolution from our own, say, this particular idea of Akasha, Advayu, etc. It clearly talks about evolution only. So then, say, for a Dvaiti, for a dualist, there is no problem. So he accepts it. Okay, the God is there, and then all these things have come out, and then there is a Srushti, there is a Jiva, everything, it is there. And then Anupravesha, so God entered Jivatmana, Anupravesha, etc., etc. He has no problem. But for us, when we say that Brahman is Ananta, not as though we are trying to establish a new doctrine or anything like that, but rationally if you think, very, very logically if you think, when you say that this Brahma is something which is Ananta, this is something which is infinite, you can't distinguish yourself from that infinite. You can't separate yourself from that infinite. So the question comes, इफ दिस दिस एंटायर यूनिवर्स इज ऑल्सो देयर इफ एंड इफ इट इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम ब्रह्मा देन ब्रह्मा कैनॉट बी इन्फिनिट इफ इट इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम ब्रह्मा देन Another possibility is it can be part of Brahma. It can be some sort of limb, like my hand or finger, something like that. It is a limb of, a small limb of Brahma. Then again, what does it mean? Brahma is an avayavi. Avayavi means somebody who has parts, bodily parts. So avayavi again means somebody who is limited. Niravayavi only is unlimited. Niravayavi is infinite. Something which is, say, infinite only, it cannot have any parts. Whereas, avayavi means parts. So it cannot be that also. Then the another question is it a modification of Brahma? Modification is vikara. Is it a parinama? Is it a parinama? It cannot be parinama also. Then ultimately what is it? Ultimately it is a manifestation, it is a vivarta, it is an appearance on Brahman. So that is what we see in the discussion on Shruti relating to Srushti. So in Advaita, where this Srushti, wherever you find Srushti, the purpose is not to validate Srushti, the purpose is not to say that there is a Srushti really in place, but it is to say that there is nothing apart from Brahma. This is whatever Srushti Shruti is there, it is a device or it is a way of saying that there is nothing apart from Brahman. What all we see is that Brahman only. And then in that discussion, Shankaracharya also introduced the concepts of this Paramarthika Satta and Vyavaharika Satta. Of course, later writers, they have also evolved another thing called Pratibhasika Satta also. We have discussed those points. Paramarthika Satta is, existence, that notion of existence which cannot be negated at any point of time. That is Paramarthika, absolute reality, or that is something which cannot be negated, that is ultimate. Then Vyavaharika Satta is something like the world we see. Every day we wake up and then we see the world and I am coming to this office, the chair is intact, the same table is there and then same environment is there. So this world appears very, very real. And then this is negated only when you realize Brahma. This gets negated, Badhitam, this gets negated only on realization of Brahma. This parama vyavaharika satta is something which gets negated only after realization of Brahma. Then there is another third one which is a phenomenal reality. That is pratibhasika. Pratibhasa. Pratibhasa means just mere appearance. Pratibhasa samaniya tattvam. That is, it just exists as long as it is seen. That's all. You see from a long distance, you see some mirage. And then that mirage appears like waters, at a distance. It looks like a lake or pond, something like that. But just you go close and then you see that it is just an optical illusion. So similarly, dream is another thing. You just wake up and then it is not there. So this is pratibhasa. Pratibhasa samaniya tattvam. Like this rope snake. Rope snake is another pratibhasa. So it is like that. So we have seen the concepts of this Pratibhasika Satta, Paramarthika Satta and Vyavaharika Satta there. Then, what else? The same Anuvaka, it also tells about Brahma Vidya Phalam. What? Sarvan, Kaman, Samashnute iti, Brahma Vida, Apnoti Karam, Param. Then after that, Yo Vedani Hitam Guhayam Parame Vyoman, So Shnute Sarvan, Kaman, Saha, Brahmana Vipashite iti. So that is what this says. Saha Ashnute Sarvan Kaman Brahmana Saha. So he, on par with Brahma, he enjoys all Kaman. So of course in this Anandavalli, that has not been explained completely. Of course there is an Ananda Mimamsa, we will come to that later. But in this passage, that is not explained. Whereas later, in this Bhruguvalli, all the Sarvan Kaman, we will see how that is explained there. Shankaracharya also points out that in the earlier valli called Anandavalli, it was merely mentioned that Sarvan, Kaman, Samashruta, but how it has not been told. Here in this Bhruguvalli it is being told. So that is what he said. So this Brahma Vidya Phalam, all happiness. And happiness is, when you talk about happiness, normally in your case and my case, happiness is because of the Upadhi. Happiness which is there in an Upadhi. And again, it is dependent on or contingent on Vishaya Vishaya Sambandha. विषय विषय संबंध जनित आनंद दैट इज दिस इज ए हैप्पीनेस विच इज डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम से द कॉन्टैक्ट ऑफ विषय विषय एंड विषयी विषय इज एन ऑब्जेक्ट एंड विषयी इज माई सेल्फ सो आई फाइंड समथिंग आई गेट समथिंग एंड देन आई एम हैप्पी एंड द मोमेंट आई लूज इट आई एम अनहैप्पी सो एनीथिंग एनी हैप्पीनेस यू जस्ट थिंक ऑफ ऑल टाइप्स ऑफ हैप्पीनेस एंड ऑल अवर हैप्पीनेस लौकिक हैप्पीनेस इज ओनली ऑन दिस लेवल दिस इज विषय विषय जनित आनंद अदरवाइज कॉल्ड विषय आनंद And in contrast to this Vishayananda, there is what is called Swarupananda or Brahmananda. And this Vishayananda is but a small sample. It is just a small glimpse of that Brahmananda. And then this Swarupananda is, that is your nature itself is Ananda. So that is a different thing, a Brahmananda. So that of course, that difference we are going to see in Ananda Mimamsa. So this is what we see in this, briefly see in this Sarvan Kaman Samashnuta. Then Srushti Shruti, as I said, the idea is not to talk about creation, but to teach non-duality, that is, nothing is apart from Brahman. That is the basic point. And then this is the same thing which we find in Ishavasya Upanishad, Ishavasya Medagam Sarvam, when we say, that is what we see. And then okay, we have now found that we have come from that, at least notionally, we have come from that Atma to the level of Jiva, isn't it? Then how to realize that Atman? So we have to trace the path back. We have come along that Sukshma to Sthula, that is from subtle to grass we have come. So now if we want to take the reverse journey, we have to go trace the same route. If you are going from here to Delhi in a particular route, and then you have to come back on the same route only. So like that. So what is the reverse rule? While telling about Srushti, it is from grass to subtle to grass. And when you are going as a seeker, you have to move from grass to subtle. So first of all, we have to examine our own grass level and then see, gradually discard one by one and then go to the more subtle and more subtle. And that is what we see in this Anandavalli, starting from second anuvaka of Anandavalli. It talks about annam. It starts of annamaya kosha. Annadvai prajayante. So that is how it starts. The dvitiya anuvaka, the second anuvaka of Anandavalli, it starts with anna. Annadvai prajayante. Oh, it's only 15 minutes. Fine, I'll rush up. So this annamaya kosha, it is the first kosha. But it is also the karyam. Annamaya kosha is also the karyam, isn't it? And then sadhaka, he has to go beyond this annamaya kosha. And then he has to see what is the atma, what is the real self of this annamaya kosha. The real self of this annamaya kosha comes pranamaya kosha. Then again, what is the pranamaya kosha is that kriya shakti or the energy level. And then what is, that also is limited, isn't it? That also is karyam. And then what is the self of that pranamaya kosha? The manomaya kosha is the very self. Manomaya, what is that? When we see that particular line, esha eva atma, that is what? Sava esha purushethave eva. So, anyo antara atma manomaya. Anyoha antara atma manomaya. So, this manomaya is the self. It is the atma for that pranamaya kosha. So, like that, the later kosha is the atma of the earlier kosha. So, that is what we have seen. And another speciality which we have seen in this kosha is, this when you come to this manomaya kosha, then in this manomaya kosha, that yajureva siraha, adesha atma, we have seen. That is, a person is established in dharma nishta, adesha atma, manomaya, where you are reading, and then you are following some instructions of this dharma shastra. So, a person is disciplined in dharma. So, it is at that level. Dharma nishta is what we see in that manomaya kosha. And in this Vijnanamaya Kosha, you comes to a higher level, Yoga Atma, Siraddhaiva Siraha, Yoga Atma. We have come to that level of Shama, Dhamma, Tapas at that Vijnanamaya Kosha. So this Manomaya Kosha, Kevalam Dharmanishta, that is in other words, Karma Yoga. Whereas when you come to Vijnanamaya Kosha, you come to this Karma, Yoga and Upasana. So this Anandamaya is that level where this Karma, Yoga and Upasana, they are all combined, they are all together. That is what we see in the Bhagavad Gita. If you want to reconcile the statements of Bhagavad Gita, we see it as Shukla Gati, Brahma Loka Prapti. So that is that level of Anandamaya. Shankara Bhashya says, Vidya Karmano Phalam. He says, Vidya Karmano Phalam. Vidya is Upasana. Karma is Karma Yoga. Phalam. So this is the result of that Vidya and Karma. That's what he says. So, but Anandamaya Kosha, there is a dispute, there is a difference of opinion about Anandamaya Kosha. In Brahma Sutra, Anandamaya Kosha, Anandamaya is said to be the Brahma. Whereas Shankaracharya's contention is that Anandamaya is Jiva only. He is one step below that realized person. Because Anandamaya, all said and done, it mayat is something different. So he is one step below a realized person. So that is why he says Vidya Karmanoha Phalam. It is not Vidyaya Phalam. Vidya means not Brahma Vidyaya Phalam. Not Atma Vidya. But here Vidya means Upasana. So that is what we see. In this anuvaka. Then when you come to the sixth anuvaka, again there is asanneva sabhavati, discussion on what is sat and what is asat. So here again, the jagat and also the chaitanya chit, they are both paramatma. So this and the, all these five kosha, the five sheets which we talk about, there again they are all the vikaras, they are all the modifications of these five bhutas only. So that is what we see. So ultimately what do we see? That it is only one Brahman which is appearing as all this thing, all this whole universe. He is somewhat like, we took the example of, he is the same producer, he is the actor, he is the director, he is the audience, everything he is. Angikam bhuvanam yasya vachikam sarva vangmayam. That sloka also I quoted. Then again, in that sloka, in that mantra, there is a bahusyam prajayeti. That is a beautiful, that is again a very key line. Bahusyam, that is what is it? Bahubhavanam. Bahubhavanam does not mean he became too many, he became many, physically became many, etc. That is abhivyakti, vishesha abhivyakti. That is what is the meaning given there. And then the next anuvaka, if you come this next anuvaka, that is the seventh anuvaka of Anandavalli, asadva idamagra asit, there we get the concept of rasa. Raso vaisaha, rasaghyavayam labdhvanandi bhavati. So the concept of bliss comes there. And then there it says, udaramantaram kurute, yasmin udaramantaram kurute, atatasya bhayam bhavati. Even if you see a very little difference, even if you see some little duality between you and Brahman, even if you see a very little difference or duality between you and Brahman, then again that is the cause of fear. So Brahmajnani is somebody who has absolutely no doubt. Udaramantaram nakurute. So that is the thing with him. And in the same next anuvaka, it is about the Ananda Mimamsa. Ananda Mimamsa means the question of happiness. We feel that we are also happy, and we say that Brahma also is happy. Brahma is Anandam and we are also happy. Then what is the difference between your Ananda and Brahmananda? So that is the various levels of Ananda, various grades of Ananda. So that is what is mentioned here. Vishaya Vibhaga is there at all levels except in Brahma. Except in that Brahmananda, in all other levels, Vishaya Vibhaga, that division is very much there. Even if you go to some Indra Loka or some other Loka, that Vishaya Vibhaga is very much there. Then, the same anuvaka makes another great statement of oneness of jiva and Brahma, that is sa yascha yam purushe yascha sava ditye sa ekaha. So that is one line which says the tattvam, the entity which is there in this jiva and the entity which is there in this aditya is the same, sa ekaha. So that is it refers to that equation between jiva and Brahma. And then the anuvaka also says, sa evam vit evam anandamayamatma, say annamayamatmanam upasankramya. So there, a person who knows that evam vit, about that evam vit, there is a lot of discussion in Shankara Bhashya. So that evam vit gradually transcends all these koshas one by one. He transcends annamaya to anandamaya. And then he is in that state where he has gone beyond any sense of fear. So he does not question himself, kimaham sadhuna karavam, kimaham papam akaravam iti. So those lines, why did I not do a good thing, why did I do papam, etc. All this sort of dilemmas and then all this level, he has crossed, he has transcended that level. So that is what we see in this say ninth anuvaka, which is yato vacho nivartante apraapya manasa saha, etc., etc. Then when we come to Bhruguvalli, when you come to Bhruguvalli, so in this Anandavalli, Anandavalli is mainly for Uttamadhikari. Anandavalli is mainly for the Uttamadhikari. And Bhruguvalli is for, of course, the first thing when Bhrugu and Varuni, that discussion, Bhrugu is an Uttamadhikari, no doubt. Subsequently, that is again for Madhyamadhikari or for a Sadhaka. So for Bhrugu, what does the father say? He tells this Tatastha Lakshanam. What we have seen there earlier is, say, Swarupa Lakshanam. Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma is the Swarupa Lakshanam. And Tatastha Lakshanam is a tentative definition of Brahma. He is that Satyam. What is that? Yato Vaimani Bhutani Jayante Srishti Sthiti Laya. That from which this Srishti takes place, that because of which this is sustained, and that into which it resolves back, that is Brahma. And then you realize it by contemplating on, say, that. And the equipment you have is your own senses, your own mind, your own body, and with all this annam, pranam, chakshu, shrotram, manovachamiti. So that is what he says. This is the apparatus, this is the equipment you have. With this equipment you think. So that is what we find. So here again, the methodology is very, very clear. Methodology is reasoning. Then, and again there, you find that the principle of interdependence of things. In this Bhruguvalli, the most important point is contemplation on the interdependence of things. All the things in the world, in the whole universe, everything is dependent on everything else. There is nothing which is independent. Everything is dependent on everything else. And this is the general theme in many Upanishads. For example, Madhu Brahmanam of, say, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. There, I read out some lines from Madhu Brahmanam also. There again, this whole universe, this whole world is a Madhu. Annam and Annada, eater and eaten. So that sort of paradigm we find in all the things in the universe. Everything is annam for something else. Everything is enjoyed by everything else. Annam not merely means food. Something which is enjoyed by everything else. When I am enjoying something, that thing also is enjoying me. So that is everything. Everybody becomes annam. Everybody becomes annada. Everybody becomes a food and also the eater. So this particular concept, this particular paradigm, we find in this Anna Brahmopasana. The whole universe is seen in this, say, paradigm or template called Annam and Annada.
You referred this Mantra Pushpam here itself.
Mantra Pushpam also. Mantra Pushpam also we referred here only. So this particular Upasana is for the Madhyamadhikari. Then finally we come to this 10th Anuvaka, where Nakanchana Vasatau Pratyachakshita. Of course, it also talks about certain dharma. What exactly is the dharma for a, what is the ethical conduct for a person? Yeah, apart from that, it is also an upasana. There again, all our bodily functions, we are asked to contemplate on them as vibhuti of Brahma. At the very sense that I am having some strength in my hands, the very point that I am breathing, the very point that I am seeing, all these things are vibhutis of that Brahma. And all the, not only the bodily functions, but all the functions in the cosmos, in the universe, all the cosmic functions are also to be viewed as vibhuti of Brahma. So that is what we have seen. And finally, that great doctrine of oneness, ahamannam, 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 ahamannado, ahamannado, ahamannadaha. So like that, I am that one, I am one with this universe. And then it is not an inflation of the ego, but it is a total eradication of the ego, total deflation of the ego. So this is what we see. It is this seeing oneness in all, the unity in all. So this is how it is, the Upanishad is structured. And this vision of unity in all brings an unconditional love for all the beings. So that is the ultimate result. The unconditional love and a sort of philosophical socialism, if we can call it. There is no socialism beyond this. There is no socialism. There cannot be any socialism beyond this. So that is how this Taittiriya Upanishad ends. And then ultimately there is a final Shantipatha. In the beginning we said, the Shanno Mitra Shambaruna Haven we recited. It said, Rutam Vadishyami, Satyam Vadishyami. But it says, Rutama Vadisham, Satyama Vadisham. So Brahma has protected us. So like that. May Brahma protect us. So in that way it goes. But here, Brahma has protected us. We have, yes, he has protected me. He has protected the Vakta. So that is right. Avim mam avid vaktaram. So that is how it goes. Let us read this Shanti Patha. If it is not there, I will just say, you can repeat. Shanno mitra om shanno mitrasyam varunaha.
Om shanno mitrasyam varunaha.
Shanno bhavatvaryama.
Shanno bhavatvaryama.
Shanna indro bruhaspatihi.
Shanna indro bruhaspatihi.
Shanno vishnuru rukramaha.
Shanno vishnuru rukramaha.
Namo brahmane.
Namaste
vayo.
Namaste vayo.
Tvameva pratyaksham brahmasi.
Tvameva pratyaksham brahmavadisham.
Rutamavadisham.
Rutamavadisham.
Satyamavadisham.
Satyamavadisham.
Tanmamavit.
Tanmamavit.
Tadvaktaramavit.
Tadvaktaramavit.
Avinmam.
Avinmam.
Avid vaktaram.
Avid vaktaram.
Om shanti shanti shantihi.
Om shanti shanti shantihi.
Okay, in this brief 1 hour, I think we have very very briefly summarized the Taittiriya Upanishad. Harihi Om. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.